love you. Color my world, just paint it with your love. Just color my world.
My name is Jim Bryan. I am an art teacher, Jefferson High School in Jefferson, Georgia. I figured out a while back that really what I'm supposed to be doing is what I'm doing. So it's the greatest joy you can possibly have is that when you are doing something that you enjoy and then somebody else gets that same feeling and that same inspiration, that same desire, then there's nothing greater as a gift. So that's why I do it. That's why most teachers teach. Being alive, I think, is probably an inspiration enough to say that's what caused me to become an artist. I want to create and represent what I saw or what I felt about it. A good spring day, a nice warm feeling. You deal with something that somebody's death and you find a way to incorporate that, overcome it. So it's the same kind of idea. My subjects range from things like I like portraits, the challenge of portraits. Everybody has the same facial structure for the most part, and yet no two faces are exactly the same. So there's a challenge to make a representational form. I find landscapes the same way. I recently started going back into studying landscapes again as the Hudson River School, which is 1850, 1890, 2000, I mean to 1900. And what they did was they used an awful lot of chiaroscuro, heavy dark light relationships, and to get a sense of depth. And I like that in a canvas, so that's one of the reasons I started going back and doing that in landscapes. I still do military art, really just for historical purposes. I like the research involved with it and finding the information and accuracy and being able to see if I can depict that on painting and still make an interesting painting as well. That's not easy to do sometimes. When you've got a nice, bright, sunny day and in a battle scene, for instance, and a lot of times the Civil War were fought, they like clear weather. You know, light, hot, a lot of times they fought in the summertime, not in the wintertime. So when you see all that, well, gee, that's great, but then to create the feeling of combat. I've gotten to where I'm starting to, I don't want to glorify the concept of war. I hate war. I despise it, but I'm fascinated with it at the same time. It's like watching a car wreck. You want to turn away, but you can't, because you just can't believe what you're seeing. So when you get that information, you want to be able to put it down on paper. You want to be able to put it down on canvas, and I want to be brutally honest. And I want to show you the severed limbs, and I want to show you the blood, and I want to show you the understanding this is what it is. When I've done airplane paintings of aviation, military aviation, the people that are there, they were basically one-on-one. If there was a bomber crew, they were 10 against one. And what you got was a feeling in the same way that these people put forth, they put themselves at great risk, at great jeopardy for a reason, for a thought, for an idea. And that's something I respect a great deal. So it's really the person I'm trying to represent mostly instead of an event. But sometimes it is an event. But for the Civil War, everyone who ever fought in the American Civil War is now dead. So all you have are recollections, and all you have is rather stale history. And there are artists that I know that they can bring it to life, and that's what I try to do, is bring it a little bit to life. And make an interesting painting at the same time, that's tough. I can do still lifes, and I can do flowers, and I can do those, but I like the human aspect of it because it's what I am. It's what we are. It's what we do. We as human beings can do things in art that animals can't do. You can teach an elephant to take a paintbrush in his trunk, and he can actually make marks on a canvas, and you can then turn around and sell it to some unsuspecting buyer and pass it off as abstract art. It's not abstract because it's not thought that way. It's not produced that way. And most artists would tell you, they probably can tell you the difference between something that is a viable, beautiful abstraction as opposed to something that was just thrown together. Because I have students that tell me, oh, I could do that. I can do a Jackson Pollock, and then you realize what Pollock was trying to do, and you realize, oh gosh, it's a lot more complicated than I thought it was. And so they very quickly will tell you, but It's the human aspect of creativity, and it's the human aspect of, it's what we all are. It's, we all interact with human beings, and we all are, whether we like it or not, we're creatures of our of environment. And part of that environment is a landscape, and part of that environment is the people that you have around you, portraits. So I just do what I see. It's enjoyable. And painting is like that. You do it in levels and you do it in stages, and it's a progression. And I'm not saying that it's like a life progression. I don't think that's, it's not quite to that extreme, but it is like, there's a feeling about creating that is, as an expression I remember reading one time, that all man wants to create. And we call it art when it comes close to what God has already done. I can't improve on that. Students who take an art class because it offers them something that they can't get in an academic structure. In academic structures, they're getting mostly a left brain function. The right brain function, the creative side, is extremely important for production purposes, to understand how your brain works, the process by which you go through to study, to understand in a simple way. That's why liberal arts colleges are, I think, beneficial instead of just going to a vocational school or to a technical school, and you can learn a trade. But this one is actually teaching you how to think and how to use your mind and how to solve problems. And I would much rather have somebody in a realm of, in business, if I was, that had a background in thought, how to think, with philosophy possibly, sociology, and of course in the arts. Because the realm of opportunity is much more open in a much more creative way. Every day I tell a student who says they can't draw that it is very possible to draw, and it is a process. And everything about the process, even told a student today, she was very concerned that her paintings are not looking like she wants them to be. She wants them to look very polished and very finished. This is a student who's just now in her second year, her second semester of art. She's 15 years old. You can't expect a 15-year-old in the second semester of art to be incredibly good. It happens sometimes, and those are the people with the gifts, but over a period of time, her skills will develop. They were developed a great deal from where she was the first semester than where she is now. We were talking about that just the other day as well. So we're trying to get them to understand there's a patience involved, there's a time period involved, and everything about education, everything about life, it's all about the use of time and the giving yourself the time to make something work. Well, me, it's a trick. I mean, it's a wonderful challenge to be able to recreate instead of just making up something that's, it looks kind of like a building or something like that. It's just to make a specific place, a specific location, and to do it to where you see a resemblance that you look at it and say, you don't just have a picture of a building, it would be, I get the same feeling from it that the artist did. And that's the concern. And that's the, to take a photograph is one thing, and I've argued with photographers for years. Photography is wonderful, and what it gives us as an opportunity for study is great. But there's no real sense of life yet in photography. And most photographers, some of them were able to do it. Stieglitz was always able to do it. I thought Edward Steichen was able to do it. Ansel Adams did some great landscape photography. You know, there's been some wonderful. Edward Muybridge did a series of studies with the human figure and animals in motion. Wonderful stuff. But to really be able to get the vibe, I mean, to get a skin tone to look like skin, and it's not just a photograph. A photograph of skin is one thing. Yeah, you get a nice color arrangement. But to do it where you've got the skin tone and it looks like skin, you almost have people going to go on and touch it, that it looks like skin and feels like skin. Don't touch my paintings. Fine art should be vital in education because one of the look we were just talking about is the differences in the way your brain processes information. Two, I think it gives an awful lot of viability as to not just your brain and its capacity. Some people have the natural gift. They're academically sound. They have that ability. But so many of us otherwise were given other gifts. And those can be transferred in ways in the arts, I think, perhaps easier than they can in academics. But then there's a blending between the three. As I always state, in what our school motto is Jefferson High School is about arts, academics, and athletics. The athletics is for the sound body, of course. The sound mind is obviously the academics. But the sound spirit and the sound soul comes from more of the fine arts. And so when you start adding all those components together, you end up with a much more complete person, a much more thinking and viable person that can do something that, if you've got a great academic structure and you've got a great academic background, there's certainly nothing wrong with that. But if everything is based upon your academics and everything is based upon your skill in a classroom setting and memorization, and then possible, perhaps not a regurgitation, but a replication onto a piece of paper for a test, and you end up with the bottom line as being the whole thing. I've never known an artist or arts and musicians and dramatics arts as well, that's the main concern. Our main concern is for creativity and for production. What we do is more important than what we get as a final result. I don't want to retire. My future plans as a teacher, this is my 30th year, so I could retire. So long as I am still able to teach, and so long as the university or the city school system will keep me, with budget crunches and you know, furloughs that we're running across and cutting budgets and things like that, it's not terribly easy. But I've kind of sweated the last 2 years of whether I was going to have a job. A lot of people have cut art positions, and a lot of people have cut the fine arts. And our strength of what our program here is here, what they've told me from the superintendent to the assistant superintendent, is that, but they understand that the arts is one of their strengths. That's one of our strengths on the campus, and that makes me feel really good that they understand that why we're here and what we're trying to do. And it's more than just painting pretty pictures and understanding what a play is about and producing music on stage. I'll stop being an artist when I die. Until then, no, I can't. I have had for a period of time when I could not paint. I didn't have the time in my day, a 24-hour day. It was just built up with my master's degree and kids, newborns, and full-time teaching job and everything else. There was just not enough time in the day to really go back and paint. I developed physical difficulties, and I think I've overcome most of them, but still, I know what it did to me, and I know what, if I stop again, I know what it'll do, so I can't. I'm just hoping and always pray that I will never be a debilitation that I can't do something, even if it's in your head. But you got to do something, because it's that spirit in which, it's that burning desire that you don't know why you have to do, you just have to do. And that's reason enough, so.